tax dollars are at work, and this time your money is being used for population control overseas.
Gordon, the U.S. government has been funneling millions of dollars internationally for so-called family planning. Lee Webb reports on this campaign in the African nation of Uganda.
The billboard states 256,700 youths can't find jobs every year. Smaller families will improve our quality of life. The U.S. Agency for International Development used tax dollars to help pay for the billboards. Dr. Cal Beisner alerted me to the campaign. Beisner is founder and head of the Cornwall Alliance, a coalition of Christian leaders committed to bringing a biblical view of the environment and development.
American taxpayers should be concerned about billboards like that precisely because they are American elitist, environmentalist, anti-population growth thought forcing itself on the way, on the thinking of poor people in poor countries.
But the billboards are only a small part of USAID's overall campaign to provide Uganda with what it calls family planning and reproductive health care. Beisner prefers to call it population control. USAID declined our request for an on-camera interview. A spokeswoman did tell me that 41% of women in Uganda want to delay, space, or limit childbearing, but lack access to the supplies and services they want. She emphasized those services are voluntary and include a wide mix of contraceptives. Abortion is not mentioned among the services provided. Abortion is illegal in Uganda, except to save the life of the mother. And it would be a violation of federal law for USAID to provide funds to pay for abortion. Still, Beisner maintains most Ugandans want large families because they don't have a social security program.
For poor people in developing countries, having a lot of children means you've got somebody to take care of you when you get into old age.
They think of children as a blessing.
Paul Bonicelli worked for USAID in the Bush administration. He believes the emphasis on population control in countries like Uganda comes directly from the White House. And the figures bear that out. USAID directed $5 million to the program in 2005, the first year of George Bush's second term. That figure tripled to $15 million in the first year of the Obama administration, and now stands at $24 million. Bonicelli believes that money could be used far more effectively.
They're really interested in where do I get a job, not how do I have fewer children. Lack of jobs means let's have economic growth, not let's try to limit the number of families.
And both Bonicelli and Beisner believe there's a more sinister motive behind the U.S. government's campaign.
Why is it just people of color that we seem to want to limit the numbers of? It's troubling. It shocks me. It bothers me.
It's racist. In the end, it's racist. You never hear about overpopulation in the Netherlands, which is 1,300 people per square mile. But you hear about it in sub-Saharan Africa, where the average population density is more in the neighborhood of 100 to 150 people per square mile. The issue isn't population density, it's color.
And USAID's involvement in population control extends beyond the borders of Uganda. The organization, for example, spent $29 million 2 years ago on family planning in neighboring Kenya. Across sub-Saharan Africa, tax dollars are being used to curb the population. And Gordon, back to those billboards. Imagine driving through any inner city in this country and seeing one of those billboards. How do you think we would react to all of that?
Well, I'm not sure of the reaction on that one, frankly. When you look at Planned Parenthood, they seem to target low-income neighborhoods. If you drive around looking for Planned Parenthood clinics, that they tend to be located there. And there tends to be a strategy to bring birth control and abortion services to low-income women. So that seems to be going unnoticed and certainly unprotested here in America, so I don't know if they would. There is another side to this, and having lived in the Philippines and seen very desperately poor families of 10 or more, it's very hard to just feed the children. And so when population control was finally brought in, it's a Catholic nation, and the Catholic Church, on a doctrinal basis, doesn't believe in contraception. And when the government finally pushed it through that contraception would be available, I was certainly for that. I think women should have access to contraception and should exercise family planning. What else do you have for us, Lee?
Well, another government-funded promotional campaign, if you will, Gordon. The Obama administration is buying TV ads in Pakistan, denouncing the anti-Muslim film that has been blamed for riots around the world. They've spent $70,000 for ads on 7 Pakistani television stations. The ads feature President Obama and Secretary of State Clinton denouncing the video and praising American tolerance for all religions. Meanwhile, the Pakistan government declared a holiday so Muslims could demonstrate. Tens of thousands of protesters tried to reach the U.S. embassy before being turned back by Pakistani police. And the police opened fire on rioters who were torching a cinema. Republican Congressman Peter King claims the White House is considering the release of the man convicted of planning the first terrorist attack on the World Trade Center. Egypt has asked for the release of the so-called blind sheikh Omar Abdel Rahman. And as John Waggie reports, the campaign for his release may explain some of the unrest in the Middle East.
Officials in some Arab capitals, including Cairo, say the anger that led to the murder of U.S. Ambassador Chris Stevens and 3 other Americans in Libya was sparked in part by Muslim demands for the release of the blind sheikh, Omar Abdel Rahman. The 74-year-old Rahman is being held in the Butner Federal Prison in North Carolina. He was convicted of plotting the first terrorist attack on the World Trade Center in 1993, a truck bombing which killed 6 people and injured more than 1,000. Rahman is highly popular among some Egyptian Muslims, and President Mohamed Morsi, a Muslim Brotherhood member, has vowed to push for his freedom. The White House, the State Department, and the Justice Department have all issued statements flatly denying that they're considering Rahman's release.
We let Hitler take a chunk of Czechoslovakia. We let him take Austria. We thought that would appease him. That would stop him, but he wanted more, more, more. That's how the Islamists are, Lee. If we release the blind sheikh, I can guarantee you right after that they'll be asking for the release of, say, Khaled Sheikh Mohammed, of Zacharias Moussaoui. It won't end.
But House Intelligence Committee Chairman Peter King sent letters to Attorney General Eric Holder and Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, saying in part, the release of Abdel Rahman or any terrorist who plots to kill innocent Americans would be seen for what it is, a sign of weakness and a lack of resolve by the United States and its president. John Waggie, CBN News.
Back in this country, several New Orleans preachers are fighting for free speech on one of the most famous streets in the country, Bourbon Street. Virtually everything else is tolerated on Bourbon Street in New Orleans, but a city ordinance bans so-called aggressive solicitation. It restricts religious or political speech after dark. Assembly of God Pastor Paul Gross says police asked him to leave or face arrest back in May. Several other preachers have been arrested. The American Center for Law and Justice is representing one of those preachers. In a letter to the city, they said a government body may not exclude or restrict the speech of private parties for the sole reason that the speech is religious or contains a religious perspective. This is a fundamental proposition of constitutional law. And speaking of the Constitution, this is the 225th anniversary of the signing of that historic document. Congress established Constitution Week to encourage all Americans to learn more about it. The Capitol has exhibits and documents on display, and the Daughters of the American Revolution have hosted events around the country. On CBN Newswatch, Dr. Gerson Moreno-Riano of Regent University said the Constitution is the heart of who we are as a people.
It is at the center of some of the most important debates of our country, and part of it is because I think our country lacks a moral compass. Mm-hmm. And the Constitution is one of those documents, is the document that seems to hold us together, and people are trying to go to it to find out, how do we live our life? Yeah. How do we make sense of who we're supposed to be as a people? And now the Constitution, that is at the very center of some hotly contested issues. So it's very much at the center of national attention.
By the way, Constitution Week lasts through this Sunday. Well, hundreds of people are cashing in on the iPhone 5 frenzy today. They're getting paid by iPhone fans, it seems, to wait in the incredibly long lines in their place. Apple shops from London to Hong Kong have been mobbed with lines that wrap around entire city blocks. Many people waiting overnight. Others camped out for a week to get their hands on the iPhone 5. The latest edition is thinner, lighter, has a taller screen, and can work on faster fourth-generation mobile networks. Incredible. Gordon?
Well, unfortunately, I'm tied into a contract, so I can't get one. But I do know people that are very anxious for it. What do you think of the new Samsung ads for the Galaxy 3 that are mocking the people in line?
Well, you know, I think the thing that's just so funny, regardless, is that when it comes to this technology, every time you get something, all you have to do is, Gordon, is wait 3 more months, and there's something new out there. So, I don't know. And I'm trying to think of the commercial.
You're not in the upgrade?
No, I'm not in the upgrade. In fact, someone called me and said, you got to upgrade. I was like, oh, do I? What was the Samsung commercial? I'm trying to think of what the Samsung commercial was.
The Galaxy 3, where they're showing off all the features the Galaxy 3 has had for a year. And have finally gotten to the Apple iPhone.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So they're dogging them.
They're dogging them. And then they're showing off the cool stuff that the Apple phone doesn't have.
See, you techies love stuff like that.
I'm a techie.
I know, you are a techie. I'm just saying. I'm a techie, you're a techie, we are techie.
Okay.
President Obama's campaign created a stir across social media with a campaign fundraising poster of an American flag. Instead of 50 stars, though, representing the 50 states, the blue star field is replaced by Obama's O campaign logo. Critics say the symbolism shows the president being greater than the people represented by the stars. But Mr. Obama's campaign tweeted, there are no red states or blue states, only the United States. The president's campaign is selling the flags online for $35. Operation Blessing is partnering with Humedica to aid Syrian refugees. Almost 300,000 refugees are in Lebanon alone, displaced by the, by the Syrian conflict there. Operation Blessing and Humedica are providing medical care and other aid to displaced families. Teams are operating a primary health care clinic in the Bekaa Valley, treating an average of 90 patients a day. Volunteers also provide food and other non-essential items. And you can find out more about what Operation Blessing is doing around the world by going to ob.org.